ever thought about running a nursery? A life under the sun amongst those flowers? Over the next 12 months, we'll show you the nursery year. The happy, the sad, the depressed. We'll give it to you straight. I'm Malcolm Hockham. This is Eggleston Hall Gardens. So you want to run a nursery? We shall see.
But this, to my mind, is one of the finest shrubs of recent years. This is hydrangea, vanilla phrase. And it's been in flower here now for about 6 weeks. And it's been bright white, then a creamy colour, and now it's developing its lovely strawberry blushes. It is the most lovely thing. And it gradually turns pink. Hydrangea, vanilla phrase. And so we come full circle, and here we are with literally thousands of bulbs. All these bulbs are potted up, and then we take them up on the tractor up to the wall where they'll sit quietly all winter. There's some botanical tulips and crocus, narcissi, all sorts of things. Thomas is working on some crown imperials. Let me just have a look at that bulb. It looks like a donkey's anus, but it's actually a crown imperial, Fritillaria imperialis. Now, can you explain how you're doing it, Thomas, please?
Yeah, I'm just about filling the pot half full, so it's got enough air to root into, but normally the rule of thumb is you plant the bulb about twice the height of the bulb, so twice as deep as that. So, I mean, we can't really plant these as deep as we'd like to, because obviously there's only a limit to what we're doing. But just to give it some better anchorage and drainage as well, you can see I've put about a centimetre, half an inch of grit in the bottom, which the bulb's just going to sit on, like that, to put it in the centre of the pot. Then I just cover it over like that. Give it a tamp down to make sure it's all well secured in, and then it'll just sit like that for the winter, and then it'll sell in the same size pot.
Yeah, it's quite nice. Using the grit is a thing you can do outside with things like lilies, Eremurus, the foxtail lilies, and these fritillaries. It just stops the contact directly with the outside soil. You don't have to do it in pots, but it's just another little thing that might help. Once these are done, they're loaded onto the trailer, and then we take them up the top, and I'll show you that later.
We've had a little project today. We've made what was an old shabby border into hopefully an exciting new border with lovely curved edges and re-turfing. And we've planted it all up. It's quite a dry area, so we've got dry tolerant plants that we've put in there. A great variety. Hopefully this will be stunning. It gives us a bit of late flower in the autumn time, which is exactly what this bed's been here to do, because it's also planted up with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of crocus, which will give us plenty of colour in the spring. So as you can see, we've got some nice low plants, but we've also got some taller ones near the front, like these beautiful phloxes, I mean, I think it just looks, it looks fantastic. And you know, as you can see up the border there, your eyes just filled through, even to that wonderful red hot poker, or should I say orange hot poker, the Euphorphia. I think it just adds a little bit of interest and actually makes the garden that little bit better. But Malcolm approves.
Out like a drum. Here is where the mavis flies, where she once came from. Here is where the mother tongue resides, far from the hands of hate and greed and lies. This is where my home is, the shore, the sea, the sand. This is where my family were raised from working hands. This is where the toil and sweat and tears knew only hardship through those working years. From farm and crop and residence, they cleared them from the land. Families of young and old, with one wave of a hand, were sent on board to sail the ocean wide, to a stranger's land or wind and sea and tide. Like those who've been before. Here there are no broken ties for brothers on the shore. Here is where the spirit will return, no more to sigh, no more to weep and mourn. Here is where the heart is, beats out like a drum. Here is where the mavis flies, where she once came from. Here is where the mother tongue resides, far from the hands of hate and greed and lies.
The little phrase is just starting to turn red. Its pinkness is absolutely astounding at this precise moment. Gorgeous, isn't it? A few weeks ago I was showing you this and it was white and I was concerned that maybe I planted the wrong one in there. Thankfully I haven't. Come on then, explain what you're doing.
Right, it got to time of year when all the seed of all the most of the summer flowering perennials is starting to become ripe and ready to take. And this is a sea holly, it's an Eryngium giganteum. It's a biennial form called Miss Wilmot's Ghost. And biennial meaning in the first year it grows, the second year it'll flower and seed and die, and that's it. So what I'm just going to do here, I'm going to just nick a few of the flower heads that we'll sow in the spring to be our stock for the year of 2017 it'll be by then. But I'm just going to nick some of the ripest flower heads like this. Main issue with this now, they've got to the stage where they've become really prickly and unpleasant. But you
well,
want to get
you're doing it and I'm not doing
yeah.
it.
Yeah. But you want to get as much stem as possible for... Is there a reason you want the stem, Malcolm?
It just dries better and you can hang them better.
And you can actually see there, the seed just physically just falling off.
It's important that you use paper bags. They're slightly porous and they let air in and they don't make things sweat.
And it just keeps everything dry as well.
And almost do what Thomas has done there, he's put the name on the bag.
And the date in which he took it.
Because some guy always forget.
Because some of the seeds can take 2 years before they're ready to sell.
Yeah. It's also, well, we'll show you later next year when we do these in the spring that it's important to leave seeds anything up to 4 or 5 years. Some seeds take a long time. These will be. These grow like bloody cress, so you'll be alright with these.
And they're very simple as well, so really, I'd only need take 2 flower heads, need they really?
Just,
but I'll probably take a third just to be sure. But
yeah.
I'll actually show you, I'll take this one and I'll actually show you that the seed holly, it almost catches the seed in there. In the seed, so if you just want to be as careful as you can when you're taking it, so you don't actually spill any of the seeds.
They are prickly little bastards.
They're very unpleasant. I just stupidly held it in between my legs then.
Right. Well, one cup for another. Yeah. The thing is that you should also point out about this is that although Thomas said it's a biennial, it actually seeds itself around quite well. So you will always have it in your garden. Sometimes I've got 2 or 3 years out of it, but strictly speaking it's a biennial.
Really easy one though.
Yeah, a piece of cake. Bloody money for old rope, this one.
Yeah.
But very effective. It does look very ghostly in the evenings. Yeah, picture the size of this tree. 428 years old. You can't imagine it until you see something beside it. Yes. What's this? There. Until you see the dog and then you see the trunk. It is huge. A copper beech. Tucker doesn't even get to the roots. 19 and a half feet round. Any minute now, John is going to explain to us his method for planting bulbs.
I am. Just finished these. A few off. Right. Okay, it's all about how you work a bulb planter. I'm now going to show you, rather than do one hole and put a bulb in and put the thing back on top, you do. That's one, two, three, and now we'll start to pop out the end of the bulb planter, just like so. This way, you can do lots, do hundreds if you want, hundreds of holes at a time. Bit of a stone there. As you can see, all the little turfs are popping out the end. So, let's say we've done however many there. Then all we have to do is, in this case, crocus pickwith. And we just have to pop them in, which doesn't take very long when you find the right way up. I mean, I don't know how many holes I did there, I did a few.
Quite a lot, John.
But just to show you.
You know, I've been doing this like 45 years now, and I've never seen it done like this. It's actually really good. Yeah. I usually just get the plug out every time I dig the hole.
And so does just about everybody else. Well, this is the best way to do it.
It's highly efficient, especially because you've got several thousand bulbs to plant here.
I have. So there's no time to waste. Got to get them in there. Got to get them done.
The thing about crocus is not to plant them too deep, and you know, that's just about the perfect depth.
Yeah, also don't want the mice to start to get them there. It's probably about 20 yeah. Done in a matter of what, I don't know, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, if that.
It was only last year that you were making this. Do you remember?
I do.
You were. It was the spoil from where we put the new polytunnel up. We call it Teletubby land. Well, you do because you've got children. But yeah, and the idea is to have what, like a grading of different coloured crocus for the spring all the way up there. So we'll come back then.
Yeah, it's a case of watch this space, isn't it? Well, crack on, just a few more thousand to do.
I'll leave you to it, John.
Yep.
I'm going to bugger off and do something easy. It's spring morning. Let's have some autumn colour. Viburnum plicatum mauricii. Bright reds. Asodissectum. Dissectum viridis, this is. The greens are turning to golds and reds. Colour of fire. Look at that. It's a pity about a bald patch. Then there are a few husbands and people like that. There's a Murayama in the background there. A Murayama is a weeping maple. Look at that. Beautiful. The stream The stream here has stone troughs in it. They're hundreds of years old, these stone troughs. And the old cooks from the hall used to get the gardeners to drop their vegetables in there. Cleaned them. Crocosmias are doing well. We just planted these this year. It's a nice time, autumn. I mean, it's what? 9th or the 10th of October today, I don't know which. Lovely time. Here's another Dissectum viridis. I cut the top out of this one to give it the ability to sort of drape down over the steps. They go down to another trough. There are two troughs in the stream. Beautiful. Lake Nephophius. It's quite early morning. The Acer, little Carlo. Not the Acer, you daft bugger. Late colour, it's nice to have late colour.
Thank you. love I leave behind me now. I can no longer stay. The orders from the castle came by the Duke's right hand. I fear that I must leave thee there.
But as usual, I can't give you a sense of scent here, but the sense of candy floss or burnt sugar or toffee or strawberry jam is quite strong. It keeps wafting on the wind, and it's coming from this wonderful plant, one of my very, very favourites, Sersidiphyllum. Look at that. That is just so magnificent. Sersidiphyllum japonicum, and as the leaves dry they give off this scent, this sweet. That's maybe 20 foot 22 foot. Oh, it's absolutely exquisite. And here in the churchyard, it just looks so wonderful, almost ethereal. There's a word you didn't think I knew. If you come round from it, and you see it against the Chamaecyparis nutcatensis. Let's get right underneath. Autumn brings its colours, its mellow fruits and misty mornings and all that sort of like romantic guff. But standing here, it's very, very humbling. Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
What I've done is I've tied a knot in the twine and I put a screwdriver in, and I've also put a screwdriver in the other side, and this is the way to get perfect curves. And you can just run along, scratch out the grass, and you can see there it just follows an absolutely perfect curve. So there's no need to guess, it's quite simple. And to do it the opposite curve, you need to put the screwdriver in down here and do the curve the opposite way. It makes life so much easier than guessing.
Now it's October and we've run this garlic trial before, and it was okay, it was fine, and we tried lots and lots of varieties, and we got it refined down to about three varieties. I've gone back to the garlic farm on the Isle of Wight again because, frankly, it was superb seed. This is elephant garlic. That worked quite well. The Valido White worked well. Early Purple White, white as in Isle of Wight, of course. And also, well, that's the Valido White again. I've obviously got two lots of that. So we've done the Valido White and the Early Purple, and we've done this elephant garlic. Now, this time we're going to use larger pots. What I'm doing here for the elephant garlic is I'm using old rose pots. These are old David Austin pots where people have brought them back to us. And you're just wanging a single plant in, a single clove. Elephant garlic is marvellous. It's great big clumps. They're like a bull's scrotum. They're really, really nice. Milder flavour. But comparatively, if we look at one of these, this is a normal garlic. This is your Valido White. You get these cloves out and you compare it, you can see there, they're not of any great big consequence, and that's the difference in size. So what we're using this year is larger pots, slightly larger pots, and then we're going to just put less bulbs in, just two or three of the cloves. The garlic's it's interesting. It's lovely stuff. It flavours your food. But you do need to watch what you do with it, or this happens. The colour is just changing, it's quite late. You can see the different reds and russets and colours like that. The French have a wonderful name for the medlar. They call it the cat's arse, and it's a very bad year this year for fruit. I was going to explain to you why they call it that. Yeah. There's the fruit. It's quite a descriptive name, really. Here's the better, perhaps a better example. I can't believe I'm chasing around a tree trying to show somebody a cat grass. There. I think if you had a cat with a rectum like that, you'd take it to the vet. But that's the French for you. These are fruits, they're the rose family, and the Elizabethans loved them, but they have to be bletted or rotted, I think. They have to really be overripe to the point of stinking. There we are, medlars. I had medlar jelly once, or medlar jam. It was fucking horrible.